Many businesses have shifted to e-commerce now more than ever due to strict health protocols amid the coronavirus pandemic. For more on this, we'll talk now with Rosemarie Ong. She's the president of the Philippine Retailers Association. Rose, glad you could join us. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Yes.
Yeah, you just came off a web conference on how to future-proof retail businesses in the new normal. What have been some of the key insights from that discussion?
Yeah, that was very, you know, very relevant, and I got so many takeaways, no? Because now we operate on the premise that we have to have a safe, healthy environment because we need to save lives, no? So almost all retailers now, they're doing continuous effort on providing a safe place, not only for their employees, but basically for the consumer, the customers, no? So the continuous effort of providing increase in safety, increase in hygiene, like temperature testing, you know, checking of temperature, the hand washing, disinfecting, and all this, no? So these are the norms now, no? And then of course social distancing. If you've been to some of the malls that reopened, and even the large format stores like Wilcon, so most of them practice really social distancing. They really follow all the precautionary measures, and even shoe bath, no? Now for this sign, because it's related also, no? So we talk about redefining the spaces, like for example, for offices and even for homes, redefining spaces wherein you have to establish 6 feet zone or radius in workplaces, and then there should be zoning on the ingress and egress, no? Because before, some stores, they only have one entrances and one exit. Now you have to redefine the space, and also you have to look into the circulation. Now for offices and even for the malls, no, you have to discard of like when you, before we just go inside, you know, but now because you have to prevent the spread of the virus, you have to discard of your, let's say, your footwear, even your, so for houses now, like we're in the retail home improvement, also you have to provide, you know, a foyer or a mud area wherein you can discard of all these things, no, that coming from outside before bringing it inside the office or inside the mall or inside the house, no? So these are the things that is, you know, the new normal now, no? So I'd like to point out also, no, like for example, for condominium dwellers, no, one of the takeaways that I got from there is that for, let's say, for condominium or family dwellers, some houses or some spaces, they only have one bathroom, no? So it will be very pragmatic. Let's say if you one member of the family got infected, no? So you have to have at least two bathrooms in the house, no? So all these things, you know, all these things that you need to do in order to contain, in order to prevent the spread of this virus, which I guess for until such time that we have the cure, you know, we have to live with it, and we just have to make sure that we take all these precautionary measures, no, whether at home or whether when you go outside in the mall or in the workplace.
Right. Well, still a lot of improvements to be done in terms of investing in the new normal. But do you have an estimate of how much the, you know, investing in this new normal might bloat the budgets of retail companies?
Well, you know, just to cope up with all this, you know, guidelines, because when we reopen, we have to face so many challenges. There are a lot of unplanned expenses, like all this, you know, all this PPEs that we need to provide our employees. Like for example, you need to provide like partition, let's say you have face-to-face, you know. This is really very unprecedented in retail because, you know, we're used to, although we're beefing up prior to COVID-19, a lot of retailers, they're really beefing up, or they're really accelerating because of the fourth industrial revolution. Some are really investing on the e-commerce. However, that's only a portion, but still, you know, in the Philippines, people are really looking for experiential shopping, wherein when you make a purchase decision, you have to look at all the senses, right? The sense of feel and touch and look of the items, no? So even if we have e-commerce, still the physical store is prevailing, you know, because the customers or the consumer are looking for, you know, added value. So they want both worlds. So that's why we've been promoting browse and collect during the lockdown or during the home confinement, no? So browse and collect, or even you call it brick and click, or brick and collect, or brick or deliver, no? So there are a lot of unplanned expenses, like you have to invest on PPEs, you have to do mass testing, you know, because you want to have visibility of the enemy, of the invisible enemy. And in fact, the Philippine Retailers Association is really supporting the Project ARC, you know, wherein we want to do test, so that we can ensure the safety net of our employees and even our customers when they go to any of our stores, whether you go to the mall or any retail store, or you go to our stores, you are ensured that it's a safe environment. You have a safe shopping experience.
Hmm. Well, amid all of the lockdowns and the quarantines, of course, we've had 2 months of that. Consumption is already down. Retail sales lower since March 17. Do you have an estimate by how much? Is it still 80%? And how do you think a recovery in the retail sector might be possible?
Well, it was really, like I mentioned, you know, there was really an impact in the supply chain, especially during the lockdown. Given that some essential goods, they did well. However, there's still some constraints, like what I mentioned, disruption on the demand, disruption on the, you know, the logistics as well. So even if they're operating, some factories are inoperable. So they were not able to fill up their shelves. No? Some of the essentials, they were not able to fill up their shelves, whether you're in pharmacy, whether in your food or supermarket. So these are the challenges, you know. And then, like you've asked about the expenses or the costs, you know, to doing retail. One is the mobility issue, because there's no transportation. So the retail operators have to provide shuttles or transportation to their workers, and even manufacturing, they have to provide in order for them to operate. And then some would have to provide lodging so that, you know, they can be confined in one place to prevent, of course, the spread of it. No? So, well, the fluidity of the situation is still, you know, until, of course, maybe when we go back to the normal, meaning that there's no restriction in transportation, you were able to contain the spread, and then there's no more hot spot, and then we reach that, you know, that curve we're in, we were able to flatten it, you know. So it's really, you know, it's really more of a shift, no? So I would say we retailers really need to have merchandise or revisit or redefine our you know, assortment into recession proof, because we are very much aware now that consumer behavior has changed, consumer preferences has changed. Priority now is really the essentials like food, and then for some non-essentials, I guess we have to review our assortment. We have to be connected. I mean, our product, our offerings as a retailer, we have to be connected to our consumer. What does the consumer really wants and needs from us?
Hmm. Right, so meaning by the end of the year, are you expecting maybe flat growth or maybe still negative growth? Do you think that there might have been some recovery by then? Do you see, because you did mention that consumption might shift, retailers, manufacturers are also shifting. Do you see some segments in retail growing faster than other segments, so that there might be some recovery still?
Well, definitely, because of the disruption of demand, there's a change of customer demand. Like, for example, for disinfectants, you know, cleaning materials, food, there's an increase in demand for that, no? And being confined, I'm speaking of our sector, I think it really depends on the sector, no? Being confined in the homes for 2 months, I guess, given the wear and tear of your homes or your houses, you know, the demand for, let's say, home improvement, for materials that you use for the house or to renovate your space, no? So you finally realize that your home is a safe place or a safe haven to stay. I mean, the budget before, people really are into going out, eating out, you know, traveling and all this, no? So it's really more of diverting the available funds or available, you know, resource that you have.
Sounds good. Well, there have been, you did mention, some gains in e-commerce, even in the ASEAN region, and reports say that e-commerce penetration for the Philippines originally was at 4% before COVID. Can you share with us how many businesses have been able to migrate to e-commerce since the pandemic, or have spurred more businesses to go online?
Well, as I mentioned, prior to COVID-19 or prior to this ECQ, a lot of retailers are really, you know, accelerating their e-commerce. Even us, our company, Wilcon. However, during the lockdown, during the first 2 weeks, I would say, even if we're ready for, you know, for e-commerce, whether you're essential or non-essential, especially essentials, you know, it was very difficult because of the mobility issue, because of the border issue, the curfew issue. So it took a while. I think it was only in May when, you know, retailers started to push for their e-commerce, no? Like in our case, we find creative ways on how to reach and connect our customers. So we cannot do it from end to end like you deliver it, no? So we allow our customers, we offer our customers to, you know, browse it online, browse our you know, instead, because they cannot navigate physically the store because of the restriction. So browse it online and they call and collect. So they confirm and then they have to pick it up, because it's very difficult for the retailers and logistics. It's very difficult to move at that time because of the border restrictions, because of the curfew, and because there's no means of transportation. So now with this COVID-19, I think everyone is really, whether you're big or small, you know, definitely it's a resource that you have to spend, those depending on how big your company is. A lot of retailers now are leveraging on it, but the small ones, I noticed that they resort to social media, like they sell at Facebook, at Instagram, or any other forms, you know, just to be able to reach out or to connect to their customers, because people need to, you know, need to connect, like you need to sell to your market.
What about the Philippine Retail Association? Have you had to mount any kind of special coordination with government to make sure that there is A, compliance during this extended lockdown, and B, how to navigate the crisis moving forward?
Well, we've been coordinating, and we've been, you know, to our membership, you know, we represent them in all this government, you know, government, in all the government agencies, you know. In fact, we are currently being sought by some of the legislators, some of the congressmen, for comments or recommendations on how the government can help the retail or the, you know, the retail industry in their stimulus package, you know. So we're working closely with them, and, you know, as a voice of retail, as a voice of, we need to be heard, you know, we need to be heard, because we all know that a lot of our, some sectors really are hard hit, though, you know, especially those in the non-essential category. So we participate in a lot of, you know, forums. We participate with government hearings and all this, no? So we attend all these government meetings to serve as the voice of the industry.
Meaning, what kind of support have you asked for moving forward, especially after the lockdown?
Yeah, we've been in touch, you know, with all the members, and there's so many wish lists, you know, and then we communicate it with the government, and some of them they want, of course, some of them were granted, you know, because most of the majority of the mall operators, you know, they granted a reprieve on the rental. They're very, you know, they're very sensitive about the situation, and then from what I heard now, Some mall operators, they're offering like a percentage of sales instead of, you know, paying the fixed rent. And some are asking for tax holidays, some are asking for, yeah, we just, you know, we just voice it out and then we communicate with the government, and it depends, you know. Some really are asking for a reprieve on the interest payments on loans. And of course, a lot of wish lists, you know, that will help them, because in retail, you know, they're big and small players, depending on how you know, some have very little working capital that we need to help. You know, so they should be heard by the government. And really, it's really a hit, not only, you know, we're all equal now, you know, whether you're big or you're small, it really impacted all of us. Because now, even if we're, you know, we started reopening in May 16, there's still, you know, mobility issues. There's a lot of restrictions. You know, what I've noticed now here is that if you're from this city, you can only visit this city. You cannot go to the mall or to any retail store from outside of the city, you know. So it's really more on, you know, the restrictions. And now there's really a change in the demand, because senior citizens are not allowed, unless it's very important, they're not allowed to go out, they're not allowed to go inside the mall. And then there are a lot of, you know, requirements that you have to have a quarantine pass and all this, no? So really, the demand and even the behavior of buying really changed, you know? And even majority of the customers, they're really not, unless it's essential, you know, they're really not that keen on going out and buying and visiting retail stores or even the malls.
I really wanted to speak with you more about, you know, moving forward. You have small businesses, unregulated, but fortunately we don't have more time. Maybe we can have you again soon enough. Lots of investors hoping the retail and consumer segment could bounce back soonest. Rosemarie Ong, president of the Philippine Retailers Association and senior executive vice president and COO of Wilcon Depot, thank you so much for joining us today, ma'am.
Thank you.
And do stay safe.